Alrighty, my friends. I didn't get a bulletin. I didn't give myself one. I normally do. He's bringing me one. Okay, good. All right, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Okay, so the meeting with Tim Beck. Hi, folks at home. Good to see you again. The meeting with Tim Beck, the new director for the Congregational Excellence, will be on the 22nd, Monday the 22nd. For clergy, it's going to be at 3:30, but you guys are concerned about laity, it's at 6:30. And I have a, Harry, I have a handout from that I will bring next week that tells you what he is going to talk about. And he also gives us questions to think about. It's too much to put in the bulletin. Okay, so I'll make copies for everybody so you'll have an idea of what questions, what's going to happen in the meeting. Okay, all right. So that's the only announcement I have. Harry, do you?
I would hope, I understand from Bonnie that we're always a little under the weather.
You're on.
I understand from Bonnie that we're always a little under the weather this morning, but I want to commend that committee. They got right on this thing about our front of our church over here, which is something wrong under the underpinning of something. I think Sean know about it because he looked under there too.
Yeah.
Anyway, they working together and so forth, they have secured somebody that's going to do it. And Bonnie can correct me if I say anything wrong, because I'm sure she knows what Roy found out. But Roy met with the contractor up here. And from what I understand, Bonnie, he's to start tomorrow morning, right?
That's correct, as far as we know.
Awesome.
He's to start tomorrow morning, and he told Roy that he thought they could do it, he and another man, in 3 days. So, but anyway, if you come next Sunday and the door happens to be closed, that's the reason they come to the side door. It won't be a life or death if it is. But you never know what they might run in. Might some may piece of material they might not could get. You never know this day and time. But anyway, they're going to do it. And just to keep you informed of what I understand, he and another gentleman, a worker, will be working on it. Is that right, Bonnie?
Yes.
And I think the two of them going to do it by the hour, not knowing exactly what's involved. So, and they go, the two men would be paid $85 an hour for the two. Is that right, Bonnie?
That's right.
$85 for the two men. Of course, they have traveling time, and they have workman's comp and insurance and all that stuff, so you can understand it. And they thought they could do it in about 3 days, so it would be that hourly rate for whatever length of time plus the materials. We don't know the exact cost, but I can understand that's probably the only way you could do it, really.
Yes. Yeah, if they estimate a cost, it's going to be way higher just to protect themselves. So,
we really okay. want to thank this committee for jumping right on it and getting rolling on it. It's hard to get people to do a little job. I don't say it's a little job, but it's hard. Most people are booked up, you know, for long lengths of time. So it's just good they could get someone.
Yes, sir. All right. And thanks. Many thanks to the two of them for working so hard on that. Okay. Well, let us begin our time of worship with our opening hymn. We're going to do one verse of this. Lift Every Voice and Sing, number 519. Okay, sorry. Please stand as you are able. Let me get to it.
Let it resound loud as the roar. Facing the rising sun of our new day begun, let us march on till victory is won.
Please join me in the call to worship found in your bulletin. God calls us here today.
We bring ourselves to God, our strengths and weaknesses.
God calls you here today.
We offer all we are to God, our talents and our inadequacies.
God calls every part of us to bring divine love and light into the world.
We respond to that call, trusting that God is at work.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come today to rejoice. We come today to meet you. We come today to talk about our relationship with you and what that is supposed to be and what you do for us and what we are called to do and what that means to us. And help us today, Lord, in the prayers and the songs and the readings and the liturgy, in the scriptures, to realize the depth of the relationship that you and your Son offer to all of us. Amen and amen. You may be seated. Okay, joys and concerns. How is Linwood doing?
Tomorrow will be 3 weeks he's been in Petersburg Hospital. And ICU, except for one night they crawled into rehab in Colonial Heights and they had to take him back to the hospital. They've been trying to get a feeding tube in through his nose and that didn't work. And then they tried to put one in his side and they couldn't get that in place. And it's still a question about whether they can do the feeding tube or not. Bob was running herself to death and the children going back and forth. They wasn't in check on him. He's not been set up on the side of the bed or put in a chair or nothing for 3 weeks tomorrow.
Wow.
He's still in ICU.
Does he still have COVID?
Very little food.
Is
still
he?
Still alert, but taking very little food, having oxygen and wires to break his heart. And Barbara says all kinds of wires hooked up to him. So we don't know what to expect. I talked to Barbara's wife every night. So he really needs a lot of prayer. We have a card for Barbara. We sent one to Lemon, but I think Barbara needs something too.
I agree.
Let her know that we're thinking of her. He has three sons, one lives in Danville, and he's been back and forth and two live over there. Yeah.
Thank you, Evangeline.
We just don't know. What does that come? It's gonna be. I doubt that he's gonna ever be able to go home. If he leaves the hospital, I'm afraid it's gonna be in a rehab. So I don't know.
Okay.
I just don't know what to expect at this point in time.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Any other updates on the folks that are on our prayer list?
You can remove Nathan and Ella Kane. She's home.
Okay, wonderful. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
But could you please add Dane Kitty Kit? Dane, D-A-N-E, and it's Kitty Kit. It's spelled quit, letter I, quit.
Quit?
Yeah, I.
The letter I and quit again.
Yeah. Debbie and Doc, you may be members here, they moved to Richmond, but that's their grandson. He's in the hospital with the virus.
Okay. All right. Okay.
Brad and Rita's not here, but we haven't talked to them, but I think they're probably all right, but I'm probably a little bit thinking they might not ought to come back as quick or something. They did have COVID, but I think both of them are back working, and I'm pretty sure the reason they're not here is a little bit. I think maybe they should be here quite this quick or something.
Right, yeah. Yeah, you're still supposed to isolate for another 5 days after you test negative. So
Rita works in the office by herself, so they told her to come back to work after, I don't know, a day or two last week, and I don't know, Randy, I think it's been working, but anyway, I haven't talked to them in the last couple of days or so, but I think they're all right. I just think it's best not to come back right now.
Okay.
They just kind of had it in the last week, in the weekend.
Oh, okay. All righty.
It's a card back there. I hate to keep on my mouth here, but it's a card back there for Matthew Cornell. Matthew is a guy who knows out of prison. He was involved in a situation. How many years did he serve, anybody?
He's been served several years. He had 8 years to serve in prison from being in a wreck and a black man getting killed on 288 right after Christmas several years ago. He's out of prison. He came home a couple of weeks ago. So we put a card like that to just let him know that we're glad he's home and very about to sign.
What's his last name?
Cornell.
Cornell?
Nancy Cornell.
John Cornell's brother.
John Cornell's brother, yeah.
Okay.
Me and Ivan baked a cake.
You and Ivan baked a cake? Was it good?
I haven't tried it yet.
Oh, you haven't tried it yet. I'll be there right after the service. Cake is always good. You can't mess up cake, right? Even if it don't look pretty, it still tastes good, right? Yeah, maybe you put a little too much salt in it. Yeah, that could. Yeah. Bonnie's going, yeah, you could mess up a cake.
Really a joy to have Roger and Dorena here with us today. It's really, really a joy to have them. Hey, we always feel so close to Mount Pleasant Church, and it just hurt for them to close up, but I'm glad they're here this morning, and we welcome them. Love them and hope they would see fit to come be with them.
Yes, yes. Yes.
You can add Mama to the prayer list.
Okay. All right. You want to give any more? No? It's okay if you don't.
No. She went to the doctors recently to get checked on. She hasn't been in a long time. And she is in the early stages of osteoporosis.
Okay, my granddaughter, Ellen, had an EEG on Thursday, 6 hours with all those wires hooked up to us, to her. You know, she'll be 12 the 1st of September. So, and she did really well with that. Her episodes of seizures are less now, so the meds are working. But they're still trying to figure out more details about it and research it more. My son, Christopher, for those that may not know, he is in jail in Chesterfield. He has gotten in the rehab program that they have at the Chesterfield Jail, which is one of the best jailhouse, different between prison and jailhouse, guys. It is one of the best jailhouse treatment programs in the country. So he's very blessed to be in there. And he's doing well with it. So those, I just wanted to give some more updates on that. Okay, so any more prayer requests?
I think Dee is having a hard time, and she'll live. She's having a really tough time, Dee.
Okay. Still?
She has lost so much weight that she's not. She said, I can't go to church. I can't keep my clothes up if I did. So,
well, we thank her for that.
She really has lost a lot of weight.
And she didn't have any weight to lose.
She has appointments this month and next month, I think, with
the VA.
Yesterday was Dee's birthday. She turned 62.
She don't look a day over 61. You can tell her I said that to her. Dorena, would you like to share with everyone what's going on?
I'm taking chemo for lung cancer that started in my lung, metastasized to my spine and my hip. Currently I'm taking chemo and it makes me really, really sick. I pray, that you have surgery on the 18th of this month to freeze a tumor. And they are going to cement it after they freeze it and then put a screw in. So I just pray that I can.
The congregation here has been praying for you and Roger all along. And but you know, they don't know all the details, and having you guys here and you telling them firsthand, you know, what the situation is helps a lot.
Love offering today.
Yes, thank you, Harry. It is Love Offering Sunday. It is the first Sunday, and in my 3 years here, I've remembered to announce that once, maybe twice. But you are also gracious to remind me and remind everyone else it is Love Offering Sunday. Okay. And for you guys, we do a special love offering, and there's a basket back in the back for it, or a plate back there for it, and that money is used for outreach into the community. And whenever somebody goes through something tragic, they'll get money from us, and that's what that money is for.
Sean, do you have any numbers in the thing about doing anything about that disaster in Kentucky?
No, ma'am. Do not have those yet, but I will follow up on that. Yes.
Maybe we could do a little something to help those people. Why can't our United States?
Will do. I will do that. Thank you for reminding me of that. You know, during those 2 weeks that, you know, I had COVID, I think part of it is there's a mental aspect to it. You're sick, so feel sick. But I just had no get up and go. You know, my get up and go when I got up and left. And so I didn't feel really sick. I had this cough and congestion and stuff like that. But I just had no gumption to do anything. I really didn't. So so anyway, I've been a little behind. I would like to say, too, and I know this is an announcement, but let's plan on having a board meeting next Sunday, Harry. And I'll have the numbers for the listening devices and potential upgrades to our sound system, so we can approve that and move forward on it. Okay? Okay. All right. All right. Let us come to our Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we do thank you, Lord, for healing. We thank you, Lord, for the healing that you have provided to so many of our members, our friends, our extended family, and those close to us, and people we don't even know, that the people of Independence United Methodist Church graciously pray for on a regular basis. And we thank you for answered prayers, Lord. We thank you for answered prayers, but we come to you humbly, humbly asking that you provide the healing and provide for the needs that those on our prayer list and those of the folks up at home, the names that they have lifted up. We call on you and beg you, Lord, in the name of your Son, Jesus, that you provide that healing and you meet their needs, Lord. And Lord, we thank you so much. Join me now in the prayer Jesus taught us as we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who've trespassed against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Will our ushers come forward, please? It's only you? Chloe, come help.
Okay.
He'll tell you what to do. You do that side, he does it. Okay, that work?
He really enjoyed being here. And they got, some way or another, we got into some olden time and historical time. He even mentioned Oliver Brooks, that used to be a historian of Methodism, really.
Yeah.
And that's where we got into this jungle place that I talked to you about.
Right, yeah.
And it was mentioned, and maybe if you or somebody would look into it, I asked I called up Roger and asked him about it, but he don't know either. It was some church that was old and independent, but hadn't been operating for years and years. Somewhere up in that area, but where was the church that talked about that?
It was in Purdy.
The church had near Purdy, and I thought it was near the pastor's property. But I was a small child. I'm just remembering it being a church, but we never went to it because we didn't have anywhere to travel and get out there when I was a child. And I broke two of my house all the pieces trying to find history that O.K. Brook went into the Virginia Conference Archives and found history about this charge. And after he passed away, Ms. Brook mailed it to me. But I really don't know what I'm looking for. I don't know what kind of folder or envelope or what it's in. But, and I think there might be some information in that about that church.
Right.
I would just like to know what the name of the church was.
Well, it would make sense that it was part of the Greensville charge, the original charge. But I'll tell you what, I'll do some research. I will, I'll call the conference, I'll talk to the historian, and they should have that information. Okay?
All right.
All right, sound good?
If you can get into that conference archives and see if you can find it, the name of that church.
Yes, ma'am, I will.
Gerald said it started before us, before independence, but I don't think he knew the name of the church either. But it's been worrying me to death because I want to know the name of the church. Not that it's going to do me any good, but I just want to know the name of that church.
Okay, well, stop worrying. I will find out.
Okay?
And if I don't find out in a timely fashion, you can yell at me, but don't worry. Okay? All right. All right, please. Abundantly, and we ask you, Lord, that you bless them as you bless us. Guide us, Lord, to use these gifts, your money, to glorify your kingdom. Amen. Amen. And you may be seated, my friends. The prayer for the Holy Spirit found in your bulletin. Take a deep breath. It is a long one today, but we will go slowly and get through it all. God of redemption, you call us to wash ourselves clean so that our transgressions fall away. May we cease doing evil, learn to do good, and seek justice. You call us to rescue the oppressed, defend the orphan, and plead for the widow. May we not forget these responsibilities you've set before us. We are grateful for the reminder from the prophet Isaiah that though our sins are like scarlet, you'll make us like snow. Even though they are red like crimson, you will make them like wool. May we be obedient and willing followers, pleasing to you. Amen. Amen. Now, as Ivan comes up, come on, I want to tell you a story that I heard this morning at Fort Grove, and this goes along with today's message and the scripture readings. There's a man named Willie in Jarrett, and Willie got saved. Willie held a barbecue at his house so he could tell his friends about Jesus Christ. Amen, huh? Isn't that awesome? All you, buddy.
Good morning.
Good morning, Ivan.
Our first reading is Isaiah 1:1 and 1:10-20. The vision concerning Judah and Jerusalem that Isaiah, son of Amos, saw during the reigns of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, kings of Judah. Hear the word of the Lord, you rulers of Sodom. Listen to the instruction of our God, you people of Gomorrah. the multitude of your sacrifices, what are they to me, says the Lord? I have more than enough of burnt offerings of rams and the fat of fattened animals. I have no pleasure in the blood of bulls and lambs and goats. When you come to appear before me, who has asked this of you, this trampling of my courts? Stop bringing meaningless offerings. Your incense is detestable to me. New moons, Sabbaths, and convocations, I cannot bear your worthless assemblies. Your new moon feasts and your appointed festivals, I hate with all my being. They have become a burden to me. I am weary of bearing them. When you spread out your hands in prayer, I hide my eyes from you. Even when you offer many prayers, I am not listening. Your hands are full of blood. Wash and make yourselves clean. Take your evil deeds out of my sight. Stop doing wrong. Learn to do right. Seek justice. Defend the oppressed. Take up the cause of the fatherless. Plead the case of a widow. Come now, let us settle the matter, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are as red as crimson, they shall be like wool. If you are willing and obedient, you will eat the good things of the land. But if you resist and rebel, you will be devoured by the sword, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. Our second reading is Hebrews 11, verses 1 to 3 and 8 to 16. Now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. This is what the ancients were commended for. By faith, we understand that the universe was formed at God's command, so what is seen was not made of what is was visible. By faith, Abraham, when called to go to a place he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. By faith, he made his home in the promised land like a stranger in a foreign country. He lived in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking forward to the city with foundations, whose architect and builder is God. And by faith, even Sarah, who was past childbearing age, was enabled to bear children because she considered him faithful who had made the promise. And so from this one man, and he as good as dead, came descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and countless as the sand on the seashore. All these people were still living by faith when they died. They did not receive the things promised. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance, admitting that they were foreigners and strangers on earth. People who say such things show that they are looking for a country of their own. If they had been thinking of the country they had left, they would have had the opportunity to return. Instead, they were longing for a better country, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. The people of God.
The word of God.
The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Good job, Ivan. Thank you.
Hey, can I say that first time?
Sure. Your wording on something in Isaiah is a little different than mine, and I want to make sure I get it right. Okay? I got it. Let's settle the matter. Okay. All righty. Okay. Seek ye first the kingdom of God, number 405. Please stand as you are able.
Seek and ye shall.
chorus of Alleluia, my friends. Alleluia. 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 Please remain standing for the reading of the gospel, which today comes from Luke chapter 12, starting at verse 32. So don't be afraid, little flock, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ says, for it gives your Father great happiness to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions and give to those in need. This will store up treasure for you in heaven. And the purses of heaven never get old or develop holes. Your treasure will be safe. No thief can steal it and no moth can destroy it. Wherever your treasure is, there the desires of your heart will be also. Be dressed for service and keep your lamps burning, as though you were waiting for your master to return from the wedding feast. Then you will be ready to open the door and let him in the moment he arrives and knocks. The servants who are ready and waiting for his return will be rewarded. I tell you the truth, he himself will seat them, put on an apron, and serve them as they sit and eat. He may come in the middle of the night or just before dawn, but whenever he comes, he will reward the servants who are ready. Understand this. If a homeowner knew when a burglar was coming, he would not permit his house to be broken into. You also must be ready out all the time, for the Son of Man will come when least expected. Watching today. Until today, they had always watched the Fort Grove service, but they are watching here now and will continue in the future. Okay, so let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I pray that the meditations of my heart and the words of my lips be yours and yours alone, Lord. I pray, Lord, that this message be yours, not mine. Guide me, give me the words. Show me, Lord, what you want said, and may all that listen hear and understand, accept and share this message. Amen. Amen. Okay, so today I entitled this message, Through It All, and today we're going to talk about our true self. And you're like, okay, you titled the message, Through It All, and you're going to talk about our true self. What do those things have to do with each other? Well, listen closely and I'll tell you. So our true self, and what that true self has to do with God. Now, before we get into that, I'm going to ramble a little bit, so just hang on with me here. Okay, so our gospel lesson this week, if you go back a little bit, Jesus talked a little bit more, but this is the don't worry, be happy man, part of the gospel lesson. You know, don't be happy, everything will be okay, everything will be provided to you. So, and now if you can imagine too, this verse 37, where Jesus talks about, he's talking about the servant, the master will put on an apron and he will serve the servants. Okay, he is the master in this story. When we get to heaven, another promise that Jesus gives us, when we get to heaven, Jesus puts on an apron and serves us. Now, of course, this getting to heaven thing, you know, why are we here, right? I mean, we all want to go to heaven, and part of it is coming to church. The big part is being a Christian, being a disciple of Jesus Christ. So how do we make that happen? Well, our Old Testament and our New Testament readings today, they give us great examples of what to do and, well, in the Old Testament, what not to do. A lot of that. Sodom and Gomorrah, Isaiah was speaking to. And then I really like verse 18, because most of the time when we hear the prophets talk, the prophets deliver a message, and this all kind of hellfire and brimstone, because God's upset with these people. He's been upset with them for a long time. He has sent many prophets to them, and the prophets keep bringing the same message. But he says here in verse 18, what Ivan read, the version Ivan read, it's a little different in my version. It says, let's settle this matter, and... Well, I guess mine's close to the same. I thought it was a little different when I heard you read it. But come, let's settle this. Come, let's settle this. God wants this thing to be settled. He wants them to be set right. And he says, if only you will obey me. If you will only obey me. As we know from other versions of the Bible, they did not obey. And then our Hebrews lesson, the promise Paul references is twofold. And he's talking about the promise given to Abraham, which of course to Isaac and Jacob, the descendants, that promise and all of the Israelites was twofold. The Holy Land, and God would be with them always. They got a little too focused on the land, if you know what I mean. They got a little too focused on the land and forgot about that God would be with them always. And then we realize, you know, in the exile to Babylon, the Israelites from the southern kingdom are exiled to Babylon. And while they're in Babylon, the big revelation in Babylon is God is with them regardless of where they are. Unfortunately, of course, we know they forgot. Now, the promise from Jesus Christ is not about land. Jesus gives us promises. Jesus gave us a new covenant. And it's not about land. It's about the second part of the promise that God gave his chosen people. I will be with you always. It's the I will be with you always part. And we cannot realize the promise fulfilled, my friends. We cannot realize this promise fulfilled sitting at home and doing nothing more for God's kingdom than coming to worship on Sunday mornings. The promise fulfilled is about service. It is about service. So as I continue to ramble, I want to talk a little bit about the hymn we just sang, Seek Ye First. Seek ye first, and all these things will be added unto you. Alleluia. You ever think about what all these things are? Anybody have any idea? I know. I was the same way. I was like, what are all these things? What are all these things that will be added unto you? Well, guess what? I have an answer. I'm supposed to. I'm the pastor. Matthew 6:33. Is where this line comes from. All these things will be added unto you. And if you look at verses 25 through 31, Jesus is talking to a group of people, and he tells them, and what he says, he's saying, again, this kind of goes back to our gospel lesson for today as well. Don't worry, be happy, man. This is food, drink, and clothes. And he's telling them, don't worry. Don't worry about food. You're so worried about food and you're worried about clothing and you're worried about having something. Don't worry about that stuff. If you have faith, if you are righteous, all those things will be provided to you. Well, let's go from 2,000 years ago to today and food, drink, and clothes. What does that mean today? Well, I mean, it can mean food and drink and clothes, right? Of course. Okay, but how about the necessities of life? The necessities of life. If you believe, if you have faith, if you are righteous, the necessities of life will be provided unto you. Alleluia. Amen? Okay, but I'm not done. Okay, so now my New Testament, my Bible, the New Living Translation, looking at this verse 33 from chapter 6, it says this: to seek the kingdom of God above all else means to put God first in your life, to fill your thoughts with His desires, fill your thoughts with His desires, to take His character for your pattern, and to serve and obey Him in everything. And then it asks the question, what's really important to you? What's really important to you? Because people, objects, goals, and other desires all compete with priority to God. And any of these can quickly become most important to you if you do not actively choose to give God first place in every area of your life. Now, before I dive into this through it all, it's important that you know the definition of righteousness, of being righteous. And that is, according to Merriam-Webster, acting in accord with divine and moral law, free from guilt or sin, and morally right or justified. Through it all. And our true self. So let's talk about who is your true self. First, there's the who you are and who you want to be, right? I mean, I think we can all relate to that, who we are and who we want to be. Richard Rohr, who I've quoted many times, a Catholic priest, Franciscan monk, I guess, he says this about the true self: we need at least an experiential glimpse of this true self before we start talking about being rid of the false or the separate self. I think the only and single purpose of religion is to lead to an experience of the true self. Every sacrament, every Bible reading, every church service, every song, every bit of priesthood, ceremony, or liturgy, as far as I'm concerned, is to allow us to experience our true self. And he defines the true self. It's who we are in God and who God is in us. Who we are in God and who God is in us. Many people are a far cry from that. Now again, this through it all. You see, in life, we start out, of course, as babies, right? So, and we have grown from babies to becoming adults. We all start out as innocent babies. Now, innocent means not wounded. There's no morality for babies. They're just not wounded. But that changes as we grow. That changes as we grow. You know, Herod, when he gave the command to go and kill all the male children that were 2 years old and under, when he gave that command, he said, kill all the holy innocents. He even referred to them as holy innocents. And seriously, and don't take this wrong, just go with me here. That's really kind of what happens to us as we mature. Our innocence gets killed. Now, Richard Rohr thinks it has to happen for us to grow up, that this actually has to happen for us to grow up. He says we have to leave the garden, referring to the Garden of Eden. And in a sense, when you think about it this way, that garden, the Garden of Eden, is the light. The light where everything is God, everything is pure, everything is holy, and we see no evil. But we have to leave that to grow up, and we go into the dark. That place where God is not, or may not be, unless we bring it. And as life goes on, we have times when we return to the garden and then we leave again. You see, this is a process of transformation. And through this transformation, we are increasing the spaciousness of freedom in our lives so that we have the capacity for true relatedness with the Trinity. Jesus talks about this very thing in Luke 15 with the parables of the lost coin, the lost sheep, the lost son. You know, we think we have it and we lose it. And then we find it again. And then we have a party. It's kind of like what happened to that guy named Willie up in Jared. You know, at some point in time he knew Christ, but he got away from it. He lost it. And then he found it again. He found it again and he threw a party so he could tell all his friends about Christ so that they too may know him. We have to lose it, my friends. We have to lose it and choose it consciously again. We have to choose it consciously again to have it. It being the relationship with God, the most important part of the promise. That's our path. That is our path. That's all of our paths. From false innocence to the chosen and conscious freedom that we are being called to by God. The baby Jesus is the image of the unwounded one. He is the image of the unwounded one. And it's our inner Christ child. Our inner Christ child, and yes, we all have one, is the part of us that is not yet wounded. Richard Rohr again says this, in our own way, we each have to rediscover, honor, recognize, and own that inner Christ child. We may have lost the vision of innocence, but the Christ child is that part of us that has always said yes to God and always will. If you think about a time in your life when somebody asked you to do something to serve God and you immediately said yes, and then you went, why did I say yes to that? What was I thinking? You know, it was the inner Christ child in us jumping up and taking over and saying yes before we had a chance to think about it. But I think in all those things, when that happens, as long as we follow through with it, we are blessed. And faith, we must have faith. Jesus says in John chapter 14 verse 18, I will not leave you orphaned. Another promise. And faith is trusting that an inherent union exists between us and God. An inherent union, that it is there. It's going to be there. It's always there. It's always been there. It will always be there for us. And through meditation or contemplation, we experience this union. And the process of leaving the garden and returning to the garden, meaning falling from grace and returning to the one who has always loved us, enables us to realize this union is pure grace. It is pure grace. Grace is love. It is pure love. It is God's love. It is agape love. And it is a free gift given to all of us. All these things will be added unto you. Alleluia, alleluia. We all have a core to our being, my friends. We all have a core to our being, as does God. And in this dance of life, as we mature, as we move in and out of the garden, as we move in and out of the, move from the light to the dark and back to the light and back to the dark, our two cores, our core and God's core, interact, and assuming we are pursuing a holy relationship with God, they become more and more entwined with each other. More and more entwined. And in this process, we learn to live with the dark and the light, and we know our place in each. And we are righteous almost all of the time. And we have faith almost all of the time. The first verse Ivan read in Hebrews chapter 11, faith shows the reality of what we hope for. It is the evidence of things we cannot see. And we don't worry about all these things that will be added unto us. You see, we accept what we have been given, and we are grateful for it. And we know without a doubt that we're going to heaven. We know without a doubt that we are going to heaven. And it makes sense to us that Jesus Christ would don an apron and serve us when we get to heaven. And we serve others. We serve others because we couldn't live with ourselves if we didn't. And our treasure will have nothing to do with things and stuff. We will not have to worry, my friends. We will not have to worry about a prophet showing up and delivering a message that we don't want to hear. Although, you may be called to be that prophet. What an honor that would be. Amen. And lastly, it will not matter. It will not matter when the master returns, whether we're awake or we're sleeping, we will be ready. So as I was putting this together this morning, as I was reading through it for my last read through this morning, God gave me this. Some of you might be saying, Pastor Sean, being a disciple sounds too hard. I just want to be a Christian. See, through it all, we learn what it means to be a Bible-defined Christian. We learn what it means to be a Bible-defined Christian, and through it all, we realize that a Bible-defined Christian is a disciple. It is not this watered-down, distorted, diluted, abhorrent definition of Christian that too many people are using, and they're using it to do the exact things that Jesus taught us not to do. When you use your stance as a Christian to be hateful, you are not being a Christian. Through it all, we fall deeply in love with God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And through it all, we live our lives serving God in all we do. Through it all. And if you think to yourself right now, well, I'm not there yet, Pastor Sean. I'm not there yet, God. It's okay. What's important is that you know where you're going. And you continue moving in that direction. Amen? Amen, amen. Please turn to page 12 in your handles. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please pray in silence, lifting your sins up to God and repenting of them. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. On page 13 under the Great Thanksgiving, the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and the fruit of the vine, and make them be for us the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Amen.
Chloe, will you help me serve, please?
Now, I think we have some the cups back there. Okay, so if you don't want to take communion by intention, you can use the cups that are back there. But we serve by intention, so you will come forward, I'll give you a piece of bread, and you will dip it in the cup that Chloe will be holding over here, and then you take it, okay? So please come as you feel led.
Harry and Evangeline.
Yes, we'll come to Harry and Evangeline. Harry, this is the body of our Lord broken for you. Poured out for you. Evangeline, the body of our Jesus broken for you. Please come as you feel led. You want me to come? Let us come. Let us come to you guys. Bernard, sit. Sit. Sorry. I know you can, but I'm going to come to you anyway, okay? The body of our Lord broken for you, Bernard. Odell, the body of our Lord broken for you. Shed for you. That's the word.
Shed for you.
Yes.
I don't think I'll get this right
now. Dorena, the body of our Lord broken for you. Roger, the body of our Lord broken for you. Shed. Thank you.
Marvin, the body of our Lord broken for you.
Marvin, the blood of our Lord shed for you.
Eli, the body of our Lord broken for you.
Eli, the blood of our Lord shed for you.
Ivan, the body of our Lord broken for you. Bonnie, the body of our Lord broken for you. Starla, the body of our Lord broken for you. Frank, the body of our Lord broken for you. Okay, now the hard part. We serve each other.
Yes.
Okay, remember, so I'll serve you, but don't take it. All you have to do is say the words, because I already said it. Okay. The body of our Lord broken for you, and his blood poured out for you.
Pastor Sean, the body of our Lord broken for you, and the blood shed for you.
Thanks be to God. Great job. You got that song?
Yes.
All right. Okay. Folks at home, I would say to Facebook, look, I have permission to use this song, but only bots are listening, so they don't care. But folks at home, our video is probably going to cut off, so God bless you all, and thank you for being here. We're going to play a song, and you can listen to it at home. It's instead of the closing hymn, another thing God gave me this morning was a different closing song. It's Matthew West, Do Something. And you want to give me your phone and I'll just plug it in up here?
If you can.
Okay. Do you have a plug?
Nope.
Oh, you don't have a plug?
Nope.
Okay. We're going to have to do it. Can you close your cord? Yep. We're going to plug it in. Okay. It's flashing. Let's see.
Which door?
I think you... Oh, it probably got to this one first. Hold on, let me disconnect it. Hang with us, guys. I'm just going to turn Bluetooth off, and that way it'll disconnect. There we go. Tektronix. Yep. There you go. Okay. All right, so I want to tell you a little bit about this song first, okay? This song is called, it's by Matthew West, it's called Do Something. And
that's the song. I've been sitting in.
Yeah, okay. All right.
It's the first one.
It's the first one, yes, Do Something. Okay, so the first time I heard this song, I was on my way to Alabama to serve as a missionary. And this song is about doing something. You know, it is about being disciples of Jesus Christ. And the other part of the song, so there's two parts he opens with here. He talks about, I was thinking about something, and I thought, God, why don't you do something? And God should probably do something. And then he talks about something else he thought about, and he shook his fist at heaven and said, God, why don't you do something? I get a little choked up telling this story. And I thought right then, it's like, say this. It's got to be this. And it's exactly what he said. So it's just a wonderful song, and I just wanted you guys to hear it. I think God did too, because he told me to use it today. So here we go.
Something. He said, I do. Yeah.
25 times on my way to Alabama, and for every mission team that came in, I played that song for them. And because it says so much, it says so much. And then there was the mission team from Tennessee, from Franklin, Tennessee, which is just south, about 20 miles south of Nashville. Matthew West came to their church and performed that song because his parents are members there. And I was like, yeah, well, oh, good to be you. Anyway, Lord, please, folks, please hear this benediction. Dear Heavenly Father, yes, it's all about doing something. It is all about doing something. Through it all, Lord, through it all, you have given us our true self. And some of us didn't know who that was. And some of us didn't know it had anything to do with you. And it was, and in fact, we didn't know that it was all about you. But we do now. We do now know that. And Lord, we still have a lot of life left in us. And allow us to continue to be more and more entwined with your core so that your core and ours are one. Are one. And we live our lives to serve you and through serving you and by serving you. Amen and God bless. Thank you, folks. Thank you, folks at home.
Let's all ask someone to be here next Sunday. Let's have at least 25 here next Sunday.